Nomi Prins is a renowned journalist, former international investment banker, author, and speaker. In her career, she's worked as a managing director at Goldman Sachs, a senior manager at Bear Stearns, and a senior strategist at Lehman Brothers, and an analyst at Chase Manhattan. Her articles have appeared in the New York Times, Forbes, Fortune, and other major publications. And her new book is called, now get this, A Girl After My Own Heart, Collusion, How Central Bankers Rigged the World. Nomi, welcome to our show.
Thank you so very much.
So tell us, give us the Cliff Notes version to start at least, to wet our whistle, if you will, as to how have central bankers rigged the world?
Well, the Cliff Note of it is that in the past 10 years since the financial crisis of 2008, at the Fed's coercion or collusion, as I call my book, the major developed country central banks, the G7 central banks, have collectively created over $22 trillion worth of money with which they've bought bonds, stocks, and other things from the private banking system in order to liquefy them, to keep them whole, and effectively have subsidized them by that amount in the process, along with having a monetary policy of 0% to -% interest rates on average prevailing across the world since the financial crisis.
So your biggest concern is that in essentially they've created a bigger demand, market demand for certain securities. And perhaps a tangential comment on that would be they push people up the risk curve. And now the stock market's created a bit of a balloon, or some would say a bubble. Is that really a big part of your hypothesis per se?
That's the main hypothesis related to monetary policies. If you inject so much money from an external source into the system, it creates artificial demand, as you say, and also just artificial capital that then gets diffused throughout the world in financial assets, but it doesn't necessarily help the real economy, which would in an alternate universe be mm-hmm. bolstering stocks and sustaining itself from a growth perspective. So it's created a sort of artificial reality in which we've all had to succumb, which is good for now, but because of its artificiality, creates a lot of risk upon us going into the future should it change in any meaningful manner.
Now, you know, many would argue that if you could drive up the stock market and you could drive up people's assets in their portfolios and their 401ks, it has a bit of a placebo effect, because now maybe if they feel a little bit more affluent, maybe they'd go out and spend a little bit more money, and maybe that spending would actually stimulate the economy. So I know central bankers might argue that indirectly that helps create demand for goods and services. Of course, you and I would probably agree that's so kind of a lukewarm argument at best. But my question is, you know, do you think now our own Federal Reserve, for example, to use ours, do you think we've gotten away from our original mandate, where now they're more concerned about keeping Wall Street happy than they are doing really what the central bank was initially designed to do?
Well, I would argue that the central bank was initially designed to keep Wall Street happy, or at least to keep liquidity in the system in the event of an emergency for private banks. It was also, though, sold to do its day job, which is ultimately to maintain a level of rates, a sort of cost of money such that unemployment was limited and inflation was at a healthy rate, and in that way could kind of create a sustainable economy. Their job was never, though, to really jurisdict over the economy. But by diffusing so much money into the system, that placebo effect has also incurred a lot of debt creation at the consumer level in order to buy those things. They feel good. The stock market's up. It looks like their portfolios are high. Why not borrow some more? Corporations are doing the same thing, both to buy their own stock as well as to increase their debt levels. Companies in countries around the world are doing that, and countries are doing that themselves. So emerging market countries to developed countries have much higher debt to real production, real GDP levels than they had before the crisis and before this artificial Fed policy and central bank policy globally.
Yeah, it's interesting too. You mentioned the interest rates, the short-term interest rates, you know, after the tech bubble had burst, they'd gotten down around 2%. Of course, this last time they got between 0% and 0.25%, as you're well aware. And then when that wasn't enough to stimulate the economy, that's when all the quantitative easing took over. So I want to talk to you a bit more. We need to take a commercial break, so stay with us, please, Nomi. And you stay with us, too. We have much more from Nomi on the income generation. We'll be right back. And we are back with Nomi Prins, author of Collusion, How Central Bankers Rigged the World. So, Nomi, you used the word rigged. So I'm going to put you on the spot if I can for just a moment. There are some people out there that many would say are conspiracy theorists, if you will, that look at how the central bank was formed by some of the countries, our central bank at least, by some of the country's wealthiest families that are out there. And some folks argue that those people still have a lot of control over the central bank, and essentially they even control governmental policy in many ways. Are you one of the people that buy into that at all, or think that's at least partially true? Tell us.
Well, I don't really buy into the term conspiracy, because to me that means something sort of dark and deep that we can't find public information to sustain. So in my work, both in Collusion and the last book I wrote, All the President's Bankers, yep. I actually look at real publicly available information and have just way too many footnotes in my books. Every time I hand in a book, my publisher's like, cut out the real stuff because your footnotes are just too long. that relate to real information in library archives from the presidency to administrations to Congress to Library of Congress to periodicals of the time to so forth. And so one of the things that I had looked at with respect to what you just mentioned, sort of Wall Street controlling and all of that with respect to the development of the Federal Reserve is the reality. The reality is that the people that met and that ultimately provided the initial documentation that became the Federal Reserve Act of 1933 consisted of a senator, Nelson Aldrich from Rhode Island, who also happened to run the Senate Banking Committee at the time, and five other people, one of whom was the Assistant Treasurer of the United States at the time, and the other four were bankers. And those bankers happened to be involved in both being wealthy as well as some of the bigger family banks at the time in the nation, where they met, which was Jekyll Island. This is documented. I went there. I saw the books, as many other people have written books on that. I saw the ledgers of who came there and who left. And I have them in a video. That's a whole other thing. But J.P. Morgan, who was the main banker at the time that they met.
It sounds like you believe that there's some truth to that. You might not use the word conspiracy.
Right.
It just it's not being covered up. It's just that a lot of people don't know about it just because they're not informed in that to that level. That's all.
Well, that's right. So yes, so conspiracy would be more of a cover. This is actually what occurred. And as a result, over history, these bankers have had not just a vested interest in how the Fed has behaved and how central banks have behaved and how governments have related to those central banks, but also a vested interest in forging all the laws and the restrictions or the regulations by which they are supposed to operate to allow them to have more risk, because there is a Federal Reserve that is there to protect them and subsidize them in the event of an emergency or crisis, which we recently saw that very big one 10 years ago.
So in a word, it sounds like the Federal Reserve is kind of sort of getting a little bit too big for their britches, you might say, overstepping their bounds just a little bit. But to you, it's really no surprise. It's in a nutshell, is that pretty much it?
It's not a surprise that they've acted to save the banks and to subsidize the banks after the financial crisis. It's not a surprise that it was done on a global basis this time relative to other times, because banks are so interdependent globally, just exacting a U.S. Solution just by the Fed and not getting the ECB and Bank of Japan involved would have not been enough.
And Nomi, for this block, we need to leave it there just because we need to take a commercial break. I apologize. But stay with us. We'll be back for one more block. And you stay with us, too. We come back. We're going to ask Nomi Prins some questions about how she thinks this applies to you, members of the income generation. We'll be right back. We're back with Nomi Prins, author of the book, Collusion, How Central Bankers Rigged the World. Nomi, I'm sorry I cut you right off there. We had to take a commercial break. You'd said it was expected in two ways, but then I think you were about to say, but there was one component of it or so that was unexpected. So what was that unexpected component?
It was the magnitude. The fact that the Fed has created $4.5 trillion worth of money to sort of throw into quantitative easing, the European Central Bank, the Bank of Japan, both over $5 trillion, the Bank of England close to $1 trillion, that the magnitude by which they acted to produce new money, electronically created money to subsidize the system was high.
So do you feel like I do that maybe the initial TARP program was actually essential to keep the financial system from freezing up, But then when they came out with QE2, Operation Twist, QE3, that those other ones were perhaps excessive. That's kind of my philosophy. Are you kind of sort of in agreement with that?
They've been excessive. I'm not necessarily, you know, they could have done other things to keep the system from falling, but certainly that money should have been enough. It was a lot. But there have been multiple trillions of dollars more since then, and that indicates the system simply isn't healthy and it is being subsidized, as are the markets, by this external force of central banks.
Mm-hmm. So this creates a couple potential bubbles, really. We talked about the stock market people getting pushed up the risk curve. That's a potential bubble. Some would argue that there's risk in the bond market. I tend not to be as concerned about that because that's the area in which we work, and I'm very knowledgeable in that area. But there's some risk there because interest rates, eventually could come back up a little bit. But the other thing is really the debt bubble that you mentioned. So I guess I'm looking at it as the biggest short-term bubble we can worry about for our investors, for our income generation members, the viewers of our show, is the stock market bubble. That's really the first thing. But then longer term, there's that debt bubble. So first of all, do you agree with that? And if you do, how can people protect themselves?
I think what's happening now after the 10 years of this process is that, yes, there are bubbles in all of those asset areas. And the way to protect going forward, because there is a little bit of rate increase from the standpoint of the U.S., I don't think they're going to go, hugely hiking rates anytime soon,
right.
but there's been incremental changes. But what that means is it's more important to look at sectors when you invest in simply overall market levels, because whereas all of this money has gone into higher risk assets, gone into the liquid stock market where it can move more quickly and become higher faster, right now we're seeing a little bit of pushback, a little bit of the realities of companies or people who are sort of at the ends of their financial sort of liquidity themselves, not being able to put as much in besides buybacks. And so it's kind of important to now look at all the things that are coming into the system to amplify QE, which are buybacks and which should be sectors and companies that aren't leveraged, that simply haven't taken on as much debt as other companies. Because when or if rates rise, they're going to have the ones with the most leverage, the most problems. So what happens now in terms of how you allocate is looking at areas where there is cash, where there are buyback potentials. I've issues with buybacks, but they do elevate share prices for certain companies, and low leverage conditions that are also not impacted by some of the geopolitics we have to be looking at, like right now, like trade wars and so forth. So there are sectors now that people can look at. Some of the healthcare area, some of the food area that's not agricultural, like frozen foods. Banks themselves are still doing well, even artificially, on the back of continued easing, and they will be protected as long as possible by the Fed and so forth. So there are just areas that people have to pick more than simply overall levels.
Bottom line is, as Muhammad Alarian, our guest last week, had said, the days of mutual funds and ETFs are pretty much over, and it's more about individual security selection and being conservative. So
I
agree completely. Listen, it's been my pleasure having you on the show. Thank you so very much. And you stick around with us. We'll be right back with more right here on The Income Generation and our next guest, Lawrence Ball.